leadership is a choice, not a position of authority. Even I was surprised to hear Mr. Rajeev Peshawaria, our speaker for the first Kiran Malkani Memorial Lecture, say this to me. To me, this was not the conventional view of leadership that has been taught to us through the years. So what's made Rajeev come to this conclusion? It could be his years of extensive global experience in leadership development, with a particular focus on uncovering personal and organizational leadership energy. Rajeev has been the chief learning officer of both Coca-Cola and Morgan Stanley, and has formerly held very senior positions at American Express and Goldman Sachs. In fact, at Goldman, Rajeev helped found the Pine Street, which is the firm's acclaimed leadership academy. And he headed Pine Street for Europe and Asia. He has also provided coaching, consulting, and advisory services globally. His current research centers around the implications of recent neuroscience and quantum physics discoveries on leadership. I'm very curious to know about that. Rajeev is also a much sought after international speaker and has been widely featured in international media platforms such as Bloomberg TV and radio, that's the National Public Radio, NPR, the Harvard Business Review, the CNBC, Fast Company, Leader to Leader, AMA, Leadership Excellence, the list is long. So in 2014, Rajeev was named as one of the top 100 global thought leaders for trustworthy businesses by Trust Across America. There are more feathers to his cap. Despite his busy travel schedule, Rajeev has found time to regularly write for the Forbes magazine and to author Too Many Bosses, Too Few Leaders, and more recently to co-author Be the Change. And I'm not sure that many of you would know this, but Rajeev's next book is titled The Naked Autocrats of the 21st Century and is scheduled for release next year. Ladies and gentlemen, I am as curious as some of you are to learn how did Rajeev arrive on his conclusions about leadership. So without further delay, I welcome Mr. Rajeev Peshawaria to launch the Raj Nivas Lecture Series with this session on leadership energy.
It's a great honor to be here, particularly because this is the first of the series, and I thank you sincerely for coming. And after listening to that illustrious description about the speaker, I am myself very curious to listen to who this speaker is. So thank you for those very kind words. Before we start, I'd just like to get a sense of who's in the room. I believe we have a number of elected representatives from government. So how many are from the government? Okay. And how many bureaucrats? Quite a number. And from the industry and private sector? Wonderful. And from community, leadership? A few as well. And then we have the media, right? Very good. Well, thank you very much. Very welcome to you. Let me start right away with what are we going to do today. I'll keep my remarks limited to about an hour, and then we'll open it up. And as long as you have energy, we'll keep talking with a Q&A. Yeah, that's the plan. So let's get started. Here are some questions that I would try to address today. Why are some people more successful and happier than others? You've met two kinds of people in your life. Those that have tremendous amount of, even if they have tremendous amounts of problems in their lives, everything is going wrong, but they still manage to keep a beautiful smile on their face. And then there are those where there is the smallest whiff of trouble and they say, oh my God, life is over, I cannot do anything. So what's the difference between those two? We'll explore that, yeah, from a life perspective. This word leadership, where volumes upon volumes have been written, what is it after all? Now you go to any airport bookstore and you browse, which is the biggest category of books that you find on leadership. Check that out in the next time you enter a bookstore at an airport. These will be the biggest category. Yet, what is this mystery about leadership? We'll talk about that. And then why are some senior leadership teams, whether in government or in business, are able to create long-term success while many other teams in the same environment cannot do so? So these are the questions we'll try to answer, yeah? So that's what we'll do. Hopefully, I will not do all the talking, and hopefully this will be an interactive session, because I have this unique ability to put you to sleep in 7 minutes if all I do is just lecture. So please don't do that, and we'll have is that okay? Yeah, very good, very good. So let me start with a question for you. The bosses you may have reported to in your entire life, regardless of whether you work for government, you work for private sector or community, how many would you call a truly great leader? Now you can make your definition of what a truly great leader is, or if you need help, here are some ideas. Someone who brought out the best in you, someone you truly respected, someone you could learn from, and somebody who genuinely wanted you to grow as an individual and as a person. So what do you think? How many of all your bosses do you think would you call a truly great leader in this sense? And don't worry, we will not tell your boss what your answer was. So if it was a zero, it's all right. Whatever said in this room stays in this room. Is that okay, madam? Yes? Yeah. So it won't go out. So tell me, what do you think? Yes, sir. One? One? How many people think the answer is one? I have worked for one such person in my entire career. Okay? How many people think the answer is zero? I'm yet to find such a person. No zeros? I'm surprised, because you know what? I've asked this question now for 15 years in rooms like this, all over the world. All over the world, and I've lost count of how many cities, probably about 100 countries. And in every room, the average answer in the room, if you calculate the mathematical average, is the same. Whether it is in Timbuktu or whether it is in Puducherry or anywhere in between, the average answer in every room is exactly the same. Can you guess what the average answer is?
All the put together.
Sorry?
All the four put together.
What do you mean all the four put together?
All my answers.
No. How many such people have you worked for in your life? Of all your bosses, how many would you call a great leader like this? That's the average answer I'm looking for. So what do you all think? One? Yeah, I see a lot of fingers going up. One. And you're right, the median answer in every room usually is one. That's if the crowd is not shy. So hopefully you won't be shy in a few minutes, because your first reactions were a little shy. Yes, the median number, as the most common number in the room, is usually one. And the average anywhere is somewhere between zero and two. I am yet to find a room where the average is larger than two. And for 15 years, in rooms like this, we have been asking the same question. Never have we been surprised. Normally, when I ask how many zeros, a lot of hands go up. So I know there were some shy people that didn't want to do that today. I'm sure there are some zeros sitting here, but that's okay. One is the most common. When we say more than one, how many twos? A few hands will go up, yes, like this. How many more than twos? Usually, if it's a very big room, two or three hands go up. But the average is somewhere between zero and two. Does this low number surprise you? No, right? And it's sad when we say that it doesn't surprise you, because you're right, it surprises nobody. But then we have such low expectations of leadership. We put these people on pedestals and in great positions of authority so they can lead us, and then we have zero expectations from them. Something is not right, isn't it? So that's what we are going to muscle with today. Yeah? Another question. This question I ask when I have a minister and his entire cabinet, or a CEO and his or her entire leadership team with us, or any organization's top leadership, whether government or business, we ask this question. On a 1 to 10 scale, where 10 is at peak potential, 1 is way below potential, how is your organization performing? Right? Can you guess the average answer on this one? Again, 15 years we've been asking top leadership teams, both in the public and in the private sector. What do you think the average is this time? Five? Six? Three? Five? Four? So the average is 6.5. That's what we've been getting. There are hardly any teams, and in fact, sometimes when we have the CEO in the room and all the direct reports, and I ask the question, instead of answering the question, everybody looks at the boss and see how she is responding or he is. But the average we are getting is 6.5. Now think of this number 6.5 for a minute. What this question is saying, that you don't have another rupee in terms of budget. Whatever you have, you have. You won't get one more person. How many other people you have, you have. So no more people, no more money. Are you, with these constraints, as successful as you can be? And captains of industry and captains of government are themselves admitting that we can be 35% more successful. That's the number 6.5, right? That we can be 35% more. They themselves are admitting that. So how to go after this elusive 35% is what I will try to talk about. That's what my books and my work and research has all been about. And I'll try to give you a quick summary in the next hour or so, and then we'll chat about whatever it is that you want to. And I'll warn you a little bit. Some of the things I will say, you will say, no, that can't be true. What is he talking about? Yeah, it will sound strange, but please keep an open mind. And if at the end you still disagree with everything I say, I will give you your opinion back. But for now, suspend opinion. Is that okay?
Yes,
yeah? All right. If you do that, then we'll have fun. Great. Can you hear me okay at the back? You're fine. Very good. All right. So, whichever way you look at it, there is a big void of leadership. The first question I asked you, where of all the bosses in your career, how many are great leaders? The answer was 0, 1, or at best 2. Tells us that there is an individual leadership void, isn't it? The second question, where the answer was 6.5, tells us there is an organizational performance void. But what is this? The answer is approximately $80 billion. What is the question? So the answer is $80 billion. This is the amount of money spent every year on something around the world. Guess what it is? Leadership? Leadership programs is a big part of it. Leadership development, of which leadership programs, lectures, etc., is a big part. Now, universities have started courses on leadership and even curricula on leadership, and big companies, big governments, they spend huge. $80 billion is only the direct cost of the teaching, by the way. Yeah? So despite $80 billion a year, the answer is 0, 1, or at best 2, or 6.5. This equation is very imbalanced, isn't it? So we should stop this $80 billion a year industry, isn't it? But yet it is growing and growing and growing, this industry. Every year they spend more and more on it, and yet we get no results. And by the way, if we had more time, what I would do is a simple experiment where I would break you up into groups of 5 to 7 people, give you a flip chart, and ask you to brainstorm for 5 minutes and make a list of what you think are the top attributes of great leaders. Right, you know what would happen? And let's say we divided you into 10 groups and we gave you 10 charts. Every chart would be identical, more or less. Everybody agrees what is good leadership. There is no disagreement anywhere in the world. And yet, this is the situation. So, question is why? Why is the picture of good leadership so bad all over the world? What do you think? Any thoughts? $80 billion, all the good intentions, and yet the picture is so poor. Why? What do you think?
Commitment
is lacking? No? But again, everybody knows that for a good leader, you have to have commitment. So there's no surprise, but you're right. Commitment is lacking. Other thoughts? Why is the picture of good leadership so bad?
No vision.
The lack of self-introspection? Compromise is the big word. Big word. Yes, we'll talk about compromise. Absolutely. Yeah. In leadership, there are no compromises. Yeah. The moment you compromise, exactly. Lack of that, right? Yeah. Not enough role models. Yeah. What else? Any other thoughts?
Lack of
self-confidence. Good point. And where does this self-confidence come from? Yes. So we'll talk about that a little bit today. Thank you for bringing that up. Other thoughts?
The system.
Tell me more.
The system circumstances cripples that great leader will
be. Ah. So I know everything there is to know about great leadership, but it is the system that doesn't allow me. Yeah?
The leader.
Yeah. The leader, that is. Yeah? So it's the environment, it is the system that it just stifles the leader's leadership. How many people agree with that? Raise your hands. Oh, very good. Okay. So we are going to talk about this in quite some detail today as to what do we do about that. Yeah? So thank you for bringing that up as well. Any other thoughts?
Fear.
Who said fear? Yeah. Great point. Fear. And the fact is we are all humans, and at some point, some place we are all scared. Now, how to overcome fear? And you're right, absolutely, because where there is fear, there can be no leadership, at least not long-lasting leadership. How do we overcome that fear? And the good thing about my job is I get to study people who reach a fearless state. That's all I do for a living, study such people. So I'll share what I've learned. But you're absolutely right. Fear is a big part. Anything else?
Fear of
Lack of?
Clarity and communication.
Yeah, you may be, but if you can't communicate, you're as good as your last word spoken, right? Right. Lack of trust. So how do you create that trust? How do you create? That's another big word. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Yes. People sometimes cannot hear anybody else except their own voice, right? And they call themselves leaders. Yeah. Yeah.
Humility.
Very good. Again, lacking quality, isn't it?
Lack of risk of reputation.
What do you
not taking risk.
Not taking risks. Of course, leadership cannot take place without risk, isn't it? You have to make yourself
to tell the truth,
make yourself vulnerable.
Yes.
Yeah, without that there can be, if all you are worried about is protecting your reputation, then that's
lack
of willpower. Where does that willpower come from? Yeah, that risk taking ability, where does that come from? Yes, ma'am. Mismatch of?
Wavelength.
Wavelength, of course.
Understanding.
Yeah. Yes. And leadership is a very lonely business, isn't it?
Yes.
So we'll talk about that as well.
Working.
Yes. How do you do that? How do you distinguish between the two? Lack of scientific mentality. Yes, sir.
Not practicing what is preached.
Oh, very good. Very good. I can talk the talk, but do I walk the walk as well, right? Yeah, exactly. Yes, sir. Lack of tolerance?
Lack of tolerance.
Yeah. A leader has to be very, very tolerant, isn't he? Yeah. You know, I'm very pleased to say, digressing a little bit. Yes, sir.
The boss is always right attitude.
The boss is always right attitude, right. Yes.
So, control.
Yes. Control. Again, a big word. How do you control? Do you control with authority or do you control with something else? We'll come back to that. Yeah.
Lack of kindness.
Ah, beautiful. Beautiful. Lack of kindness. You know, I'll make two comments before I begin, based on everything that you all have said. One is, when you said tolerance, right? Recently, I've been studying leadership in the Middle East. There is one country, UAE, that stands out compared to other countries. You go to Dubai or Abu Dhabi, and you go to Saudi Arabia, you can see the difference. And Saudi Arabia has a lot more money than UAE has, by the way. So it's not because of oil wealth, right? Because Saudi is much richer, but... Here's how great Sheikh Mohammed's leadership is, that recently, some of you may be knowing this, they have recently created two new ministries. One ministry of tolerance and the other is a ministry of happiness. Did you all know that?
Yes.
And both of these are headed by women under 35. In the Middle East, a ministry of tolerance headed by a 35-year-old woman. So people are getting the message, right? And then about kindness, you mentioned kindness, right? We did another study recently at Wharton Business School, all right? Business leaders, we are talking business leaders who go after dollars and cents, rupees and paise. The most successful business leaders in material terms, as in money and status, right? The number top two qualities of these people, you would think are ruthless, vision and commitment and this, that and the other. No. The number two qualities were forgiveness and compassion. Talk about kindness. So, you know, the whole notion of leadership is a turning itself upside down. So I'll share some of that with you. Very good. Thank you for sharing your views on this. You're all right. I'm going to give you just a few things that in addition that we have picked up, and then we'll go into the meat of what is leadership. So we think it's because of some myths about leadership. Some misconceptions about the word leadership itself. So let me show you some of those myths. The first myth about leadership is that leadership is confused with followership. Now this may sound confusing to you. Followership plus pleasing equals leadership. That is the general belief. We have been confusing followership in the name of leadership since time immemorial. Let me explain. When we are parents, we literally whack our children into obeying us, isn't it? When they obey us, when they listen to us, we love them and we reward them. But when they are rebels, we don't, isn't it? So right from when we are children, parents love their children when they listen and obey. So followership and obedience is considered leadership. Our child is a beautiful child, is a very well-behaved child. He always listens or she always listens. Great. Leadership confused with followership, isn't it? Now, you go to school and college and the same thing happens. Professors, teachers, though they reward in general, not all, I know there are people from academia here, so I don't mean this as a disrespect, but in general, a lot of teachers reward those students who listen to them and do exactly what they are told. A student who is a rebel and asks too many questions is usually gets it. Thomas Edison, the inventor of the light bulb, was thrown out of class. Why? Because he asked too many questions. I will never forget my own situation. During my MBA studies, I took an elective course on international relations. And this professor, this American professor, had a very interesting take on US-Russia relationship balance during the Cold War. Right? Nobody agreed with him or his ideas. And he would say, okay, now it's time for you to take the exam and do the term paper. I will not penalize you for your political opinion. You must write in the paper what you think, not what I am saying. I have given you my reasoning and my logic as to why I have this opinion. You give me yours. And you don't have to agree with me, and I will not grade you whether you agree with me or not. So we said, oh, nice man. At least he allows us the freedom, right? So I was very well prepared to write the paper based on my views. But luckily, I met a senior who had taken the same class last year with the same professor. He said, don't make that mistake. Write exactly what you heard in class. And I did that, and I got an A grade. But I was only one of two people who got an A grade in the whole class. Everybody who gave their independent opinion got B's and C's. So, whether at home or in the classroom, school and college, we confuse followership with leadership, we reward followership and call that person a leader. Oh, you are the leader of the class. You do exactly what I say. You see, so then when you are working in a company or in any place, you ask, in private sector, this is a thing, that, a manager's success is determined by how liked she is by the people, right? So when my success as a manager depends upon whether my people like me or not, what do? I very quickly learn that I need to please the people that work for me. And pleasing is another form of followership. Then I start giving my people what they want, not necessarily what they need. You see? So especially in large international companies, we have something called an employee engagement survey, where the people that work for you give you a score of whether you are a good leader or not. And then half of my bonus depends on what my score is. What do you think I do? I don't make the difficult decisions. I do things that please them. So in school, after school and college, in the workplace also, followership is rewarded in the name of leadership. And then when you are in the boardroom of a company, or you are in the top echelons of government, and you present new ideas which have never been tested before to your highest authorities, even though you are a very senior minister or a CEO, you present to your board or your cabinet some of the highest level final presentation that this is what we should do. What is the first question they ask? Where has this been done before? Where is the report from McKinsey and Company that says that 10 other organizations have done it successfully? Where is the best practice? Well, last time I checked the dictionary, following somebody else's best practice was an act of followership, not leadership. So right from when we are young till the end, followership is confused in the name of leadership. Talk about being safe. You want to be safe? Do what others are doing. Your bosses will never penalize you. Only problem with that is you will be very successful. Only problem is that's not leadership. Then don't call yourself a leader. Right? So that's the first myth. Followership is leadership. The second one is a position of authority is leadership. Now, only if you give me great position of authority can I be a leader. Otherwise, what can I do? Nobody will listen to me. I don't have a title. I don't have a position. So how can I lead? Correct? And especially the senior people in government and in business, they give me a lot of responsibility, but they don't give me authority. So how can I be a good leader? This is the most common refrain from a lot of people. A few years ago, I wrote an article in Forbes magazine called Powerful Victims. Why powerful victims? These are people with great titles and great authority, and they say, I cannot do anything because the powers above me don't allow me to. I mean, I cannot understand this idea. You think about three of the greatest examples of leadership from the previous century, from the 20th century, from west to east, Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, and Mahatma Gandhi. What do these three leaders have in common? No authority, no title, no position for most of their lives. And three of the best examples of leadership, most powerful examples I've given you. So what is this idea that I don't have authority? So my only humble request to all of you distinguished guests today, next time you feel that somebody is stopping you, please don't feel helpless. Because Gandhiji never had any position. Yet he was one of the most powerful leaders, not only of our country, but of the whole world. The moment we feel helpless, that's the end of the game. You don't lose to the rest of the world, you lose to your own mind. And that was the greatness of Nelson Mandela. 27 years of wrongful imprisonment, and yet he never gave up hope. Yet for not one second did he feel, I am helpless, these people are keeping me captive. And the best part is, even though he was in prison for 27 years, he was still a leader in the hearts and minds of South Africans. You can't hear him, you can't see him. How can you remain alive in people's hearts? We will uncover that mystery as we go along. Yeah. So this idea that, you know, I have to have a title and position in order to lead, not a great idea. Leaders are born, not made. Ultimately, when I talk to people, they say, you know what, this is God-given. Some people have that thing in them. It's genetic, it's hereditary, whereas some people are born without it. Now, interestingly, as a researcher and student of leadership, I wanted to prove that this is true, that leaders are indeed born. There is a God-given gene that only some people have and others don't have. Why did I want to prove it? Then we can shut down the $80 billion industry, isn't it? Because the proof is there. And I can get the Nobel Prize, Peace Prize or Nobel Prize in economics. But unfortunately, no such luck. I tried for 2 whole years to prove this, that leadership is genetics or hereditary, and I could find zero proof. Sorry? Are they? Or are they not? In fact, what I have found in most places, whether in the public sector or in the private sector, government or family, these dynasties, if it was true that leadership was genetic, then the next generation should be better than the previous generation in terms of leadership, isn't it? But in most dynasties, it goes in the wrong direction. The next generation and the next generation is worse leaders than previous, if you can call them leaders at all, right? So we couldn't prove it. And by default, then we had to believe that leaders are indeed made. Now, I will say one thing. A leader in you is born, but not at the time of your biological birth. So let me repeat, a leader in you is born, but not at the time of your biological birth. A leader in you is born when two things happen to you simultaneously. One, you feel deeply about the inadequacies of current reality. Something about today bothers you so much that you cannot sleep at night. And two, you decide to do something about it. The first one, a lot of people have. But the second one is what needs the courage. And that's what a lot of people don't have. When both things happen to you together, then the leader in you is born. Not at the time of your biological birth. So anyway, we couldn't prove this one. And finally, another one. The $80 billion industry is mostly used on things like, let's teach you the best practice of others. You go to Harvard Business School or Stanford or Oxford or Cambridge for a course on leadership for 1 week or 2 weeks. All you will do after paying $20,000 is read case studies, case studies, case studies, and case studies. Because Harvard says the best way to learn leadership is to read about and learn from other people's mistakes. And I say, no, Harvard, you do not learn leadership by reading about and discussing other people's mistakes. You learn leadership when you make your own mistakes, when you fall multiple times and learn how to get up. Yes?
When something cannot break you, it makes you.
It makes you stronger, doesn't it? Exactly. So how can you become this great leader by sitting in a classroom reading case studies? But that's what $80 billion is spent on, best practice. And then what happens in a lot of places, both in government and in bureaucracy and private sector, is we look at leaders of yesteryears. What made that leader great, right? And we make a beautiful PowerPoint slide with beautiful words about this leader's great qualities were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's called a competency model. That made this leader successful in the last 20 years. And then we teach it to the next generation. You do the same thing that she did in the last 20 years, you will be as successful in the next 20 years. Those days are over. Today the world changes in 1 week, right? That competency modeling was great until 1985 when Jack Welch was running GE. It doesn't work today. But yet, we have this rear view mirror approach of looking at leadership. So hence the 80 billion is quite useless. Point is that none of this is leadership, but this is how the world thinks about leadership. Either we confuse followers for leaders, right? Or we teach them backward looking stuff which is not relevant anymore, because today the world is changing every day as we speak, right? Or we think about authority and feel helpless, oh my God, I don't have authority. If I have more authority, I will be a great leader. If I have more money, I will be a happy person. If I have more this, then I will do something for society. We keep postponing not only our happiness, but we keep postponing our leadership also. And one day we leave the world. So the question is, if none of this is leadership, then what is leadership? To answer this question, I'd like you to watch a quick video clip. And this is none other than, I'm so glad I'm in India today, because when I'm in some parts of the world, I even have to explain who this great man is. I don't have to give any explanations today, so just watch.
Papu is already late for prayers.
Oh, God. Oh.
Tum tum pramada bhavishanti yatra tadvat kamayam bhavishanti sarve sashanti nasmati matam.
The object of this massive tribute died as he had always lived, a private man, without wealth, without property, without official title or office. Mahatma Gandhi was not the commander of armies nor a ruler of vast lands. He could not boast any scientific achievement or artistic gift. Yet men, governments, dignitaries from all over the world have joined hands today to pay homage to this little brown man in the loincloth who led his country to freedom. In the words of General George C. Marshall, the American Secretary of State, Mahatma Gandhi has become the spokesman for the conscience of all mankind. He was a man who made humility and simple truth more powerful than empires. And Albert Einstein added, generations to come will scarce believe that such a one as this, ever in flesh and blood, walked upon this earth.
So again, you see what he said. What did Gandhi not have? No power, no wealth, no title, none of this. And yet he is one of the most powerful examples of leadership. Question is, what made him so great? And that's the mystery that we will unravel as to, if leadership is not all those things that we always believed it was, then what is it? It's not a title, it's not a position, it's none of those things, then what is it? And he was a man who didn't have any special abilities or great skills at anything either. And yet one of the most respected names in leadership. You may be wondering, yes sir?
Confidence, courage.
And where does all that come?
And selflessness.
And where does all that come from? Where does that come from? Yes, sir, but we all have it within us, but why doesn't it come out? It only comes out for one Gandhi. That is the question.
But I think it could be
Non-resistance meaning his non-violent movement?
No, no, not non-violent. Like, he didn't resist anything actually.
That's right. That's right. So again, we are going to unpack this mystery as to how what he discovered, can we learn a little bit as well? And what does it mean to me? Because I am not a great soul like Gandhi. I am an ordinary person. I will be nowhere near ever have the kind of courage that he had. But can I get a little better than that?
It is contextual, sir.
It is contextual. Say more, sir. What do you mean by contextual?
The circumstances at that time.
Yes. So you are right about one thing, that the more difficult the circumstances, the greater the need for leadership.
The deprivation.
And yes, but there is never a time in history where the circumstances don't call for better leadership. Do you think we need more better leadership today? Of course we do, right? There is ever a time in history where it was not. Circumstances always present the opportunity, but very few people take it. That's the point. So we'll get to the bottom of that. How? That's right. So I'm going to try and simplify this a little bit for you so that we can apply and take away something today for all of us, right? As to what can I do? If I don't have that kind of courage, then what can I do? So we'll go there in a minute. Yeah. But before we go to people like Gandhi and Mandela, I want to tell, because you know, when people tell me stories of Gandhi and Mandela and your Honorable Lieutenant Governor and other people who have this tremendous amount of courage, I feel even smaller than I am. Oh my God, I don't have this kind of courage. I don't have this kind of ability. I feel even smaller than who I am. So I feel even less hope that I can ever do anything. So if you are feeling somewhat like that, then let me tell you a very odd, actually not an ordinary story, an extraordinary story, but of a very ordinary man. Okay, so try to picture this with me. It's 1960. A 7-year-old boy is playing in the compound of his project housing building. Now, project housing in the United States, by the way, project housing is government subsidized housing for very, very poor people. So it's December, it's very cold, and he's picking up snow from the floor and throwing it at neighboring kids and having a good time. It's about 8 p.m. And his mother sticks her head out from a window a few floors above and says, "Hey, you, come up, I want to talk to you." So he goes running up. He says, "Yes, mom, what's up?" And she says, "Your father has had a terrible accident. I need to rush to the hospital. I need you to look after your little brother and your little sister while I'm gone." And off she goes. He's himself 7 years old, right? 4 hours later, an ambulance is now driving into the compound, and four men carrying his father on a stretcher walk up the stairs, there's no lift, and put him on his bed. His father has a plaster from hip to toe, multiple fractures on his right leg, and some other injuries as well. His father is a temporary truck driver. Yeah? So he only can make money when a company needs extra truck drivers, so he can make some money. He had an accident and he broke his leg and certain other body parts. He's going to be laid up for 3 months. Right? As a temporary worker, he has no medical insurance, and the total income for a year for this family of five is about $18,000. Very poor by New York standards. Right? And he's going to be down for 3 months, which means no income and a lot of expenses for medical treatment. His parents teach him over the next few weeks and months how to answer the phone when bill collectors call to collect money. Tell them your parents are not home. Yeah? When he's still hungry for dinner and he reaches for the second piece of bread, mother says, "No, make do with just one piece of bread because we have to save some money for daddy's medicines." Life is tough for this guy. He soon notices that because his father can never hold on to a job, he notices now neighbors stop playing with him. Nobody wants to talk to them because they are scared. We will ask for money, we will ask for favors. So we walk this way, everybody walks that way. Society is leaving them behind. What is going on? Just because we are poor. Nobody is treating them with basic respect and dignity that every human being deserves. And he says, why? And he cannot find the answers. Has a very, very difficult childhood. Now he's 17 years old. Okay. And he swears to himself, when I grow up, I will make sure nobody around me is left behind the way society left us behind. Nobody around me will be treated without the basic respect and dignity that every human being deserves. Because I will create a company, a kind of company that my father never had the chance to work for, where these kinds of values are upheld. Right? Now, leave alone starting a company. Are you with me on the story so far?
Yes.
You're following? Okay. He doesn't have money to go to college even. But luckily, he's a very good football player, and he manages to get into a state college in America, not a fancy college like Harvard or anything, very ordinary state college, Northern Michigan, on a football scholarship, right? But as bad luck would have it, in his first year, he injures himself and can never play football again, so he loses his scholarship. Now he works in the factory at night and goes to college in the morning. Somehow he goes through college. Often he will go to the blood bank to sell his own blood, so on that day he can buy some good food. That's how hard it was, right? But somehow he gets through to college. Now, he is no genius. He is a B grade student, B average student. Never received an A grade his entire 4 years of college. Yeah, so nothing special about him. He did not study chemistry or physics or whatever. He studied humanities. Very ordinary chap. But at the end of college, he gets a job as a salesman in Xerox company selling photocopying machines. But he works very hard. He sells more machines than all the others, and very soon, in a few years, he's making $75,000 a year. This is in the late 70s, early 80s. I'm talking about a lot of money in those days, right? More money than his entire clan in his family has ever seen in the Brooklyn projects, and he's the hero. Wow. Fast forward a few more years, he's now making $100,000, $1 lakh a year. He has a company expense account. He lives in a beautiful apartment in a fashionable part of New York. Great. Life is superb. He's now working for a company called Thermoplast. Yeah? And he is living there with his girlfriend, who is the love of his life. Fast forward some more, his girlfriend is now his wife, and she's expecting their first child. She's 5 months pregnant. And he's making $100,000, he's got a nice flat, he's got a car, life is great. More responsibility coming, right? At this time of his life, he quits. He's still 28 years old. He quits his $100,000 plus job, relocates his pregnant wife all the way to the other side of the country, to the West Coast, and joins a tiny little unknown company that pays one third of what he's earning in New York. Give up a big job in Thermoplast, go and work for one third in a city you've never been before, especially when there is responsibility on the way. He has gone crazy, isn't it? Lost it completely. Is this what you worked so hard for? No, he hasn't gone crazy. He has not forgotten his promise to himself. Now let me tell you the rest of the story, that he, after a few years, the owners of that small little company want to sell the company. And he somehow manages to buy the company and makes himself the CEO. And with that is born the world's first company that provides full healthcare benefits, even to part-time workers. First company. And then, till today, that company has become a massive multinational. It's all over India, it's all over the world. You cannot miss it, right? And till today, this company is run on only two values and two principles. Inclusion, I will make sure nobody is left behind. And respect, I will make sure everybody is respected, right? And till today, this company spends more money on employee benefits than it spends on buying raw materials. Anybody from the finance industry here? Would you ever lend money to a company that spends more on benefits and less on raw material? Probably not, if you were a banker. But this company continues to be super successful and growing and growing and growing, and it's not even a technology company. Anybody guess who I'm talking about? Who is this person and which is this company? No? I'll tell you. Starbucks. Howard Schultz is his name. This was that seven-year-old boy. But here's the best part of the story. When he wanted to buy that tiny little Starbucks company, that time they had only three stores in Seattle, Washington, the price tag was $4 million. Remember, he is now working for peanuts. He has no money. Here's the big part. He went knocking on the doors of 242 investors. Knock, knock, invest in my coffee bean company. Knock, knock, invest in my coffee bean company. 230 out of 242 said, get out of here. Are you crazy? Not only did they say no, but they rejected him insultfully. But he kept going, kept going, kept going until he raised the money, and the rest, as they say, is history. My question to you is, what would you do after 230 insultful rejections? What would you do?
Probably quit.
Probably quit, isn't it? What would you do if you, after 20 insultful rejections? If you are like me, probably you will quit. The secret of leadership, if you want to know, is why did he not quit after 230? The secret of leadership is, despite all that they did to him, why did Mahatma Gandhi not quit against the biggest military power of its time? And why did Nelson Mandela not quit even after 27 years of wrongful imprisonment? Where does that kind of power come from? They were also made of the same flesh, blood, molecules and atoms as you and I. Then where do they get this that others don't get? And can we, lesser mortals, get some of that? The answer is a big yes, and I'll show you how. Not because I know something more than you do, it's just because I get to study people like that, and so that's why I'm able to say something. But was this a remarkable story?
Yes.
Yeah? Of a very ordinary person like you and me? No special abilities, again. Neither did Mandela, nor did Gandhiji, nor did Martin Luther. None of them have extraordinary abilities. Everybody has these abilities. Somehow they know how to take it out. And one of you said it's all internal, it's all inside. How do you take it out is the key question. Right? So, what do these people have in common? Whether it's Howard Schultz, whether it's Gandhi, whether it's Mandela, what do they have in common?
Perseverance.
Yes. But what were they trying to do? Each of them change for what? Yes. Would it be fair to say that they were all trying to create a tomorrow that is better than today for their people and for themselves? Correct? That, my friends, is the definition of leadership. Yes, leadership is the art of creating a better future. Your leadership does not begin when you become appointed as president or CEO. Your leadership does not begin when you win an election. Your leadership begins when you close your eyes and imagine a better future. Everybody can close their eyes and imagine a better future. That's when leadership begins. Title, position, all that is extra. Most of us don't know how to close our eyes. That is the problem, right? And our own past president, Abdul Kalamji, used to say that, you know, there are dreams that you have when you are asleep. Those are useless. You will forget them 5-10 minutes after waking up. It's the dreams that keep you from sleeping are the ones worth having. What is the dream that keeps you from sleeping? Are you able to close your eyes and imagine a better future? If you can, now your leadership journey has begun. Correct, I'm coming to that. Just give me a minute. I'm coming exactly to that. Now, I have spent half an hour selling you this vision that this is the way to live. And I'm going to say something very strange. Believe what you see on the screen at your own risk. Why did I say something so strange? I spent half an hour trying to sell you a philosophy for life, and now I'm saying believe it at your own risk. What happens when you say to people, hey, I have a vision for a better future, come join me? What do people say? Generally speaking, what do people say? Especially when you don't have much authority.
Get lost.
Exactly. Are you crazy? And by the way, it happens even to people with authority, right? Get lost is the most common answer, right? What makes you think so? They'll give you friendly advice. Don't try it. Don't risk your life. Don't risk your career. It won't work. We've tried this before. You ignore the advice and you get started. Now what do they do to you? Do they give you undying support? Exactly. Now they give you all kinds of resistance. Active resistance, passive resistance, all kinds of resistance. So the constant companion of leadership, if you think about life and leadership like this, is going to be resistance, resistance, and resistance. And if you think Prime Minister Modi doesn't have resistance, he does. If you think the greatest leaders of our country or the world don't have resistance, President Obama didn't have resistance. He tried to give universal health care to all Americans and he had resistance for that too. So whether powerful or not, your constant companion, if you truly discover leadership like this, is resistance. So now that you know that the constant companion of leadership is resistance, right? Let me ask you the fundamental question. What is the main ingredient for leadership? What is required? Because the difference between a leader and a non-leader is simply this. Non-leaders give up in the face of resistance, right? So what makes Nelson Mandela not give up? What is that thing that they have that others don't have?
Confidence.
Patience.
Energy.
Perseverance. Tenacity. And if I could combine all these words, if I could take editorial license and combine, I would use your word, and the word is energy. You need to have a deep, deep reservoir of intrinsic energy. It's almost a spiritual kind of energy, not religious, although could be religious, but doesn't have to be, a spiritual kind of energy that these people discover inside them, because of which they never give up. So first, let's complete the definition. Leadership is the art of dreaming up and imagining a better future. And for that, you're going to have to dig deep and find your own energy first, harness it, and then use that power to harness other people's energy. The $1 million or the $1 billion question is, where does such energy come from? How do these people discover and uncover this kind of energy? That's the question that we are going to try to answer. And the first place to do that is to find your own energy. Only then can I energize you, if I can find my own energy, isn't it? So how do I find this kind of long-lasting, undying energy? So what is this thing called leadership energy? It is that force within that prevents you from giving up. That's what Gandhi had, that's what Mandela had, that's what Howard Schultz had, and I can give you many, many more examples, right? How do you find this? Can anybody guess what are the sources of this long-lasting energy? Now, it's not money, it's not fame, because those things give you temporary energy. So long-lasting energy that makes you go 27 years in prison, where does it come from? What are the sources of such energy? What do you think? Positive thoughts, very good. Passion for some ideals, yes. Deep thinking. Yes, all of these are right. All three of you are correct. But deep thinking for what? Ideals for what? Yeah? So greater good is true. But again, generally we think of leadership as greater good, isn't it? But what if somebody is trying to create a better future only for himself or herself? Is he or she not a leader? No, I'll come back. Sir, is that so? Somebody who wants a better future only for me, is that person a leader? You have to do it for greater good. Well, is Roger Federer a leader? Of course he is. It's called self-leadership. It's called self-leadership. And then he inspires many others to reach those heights. So there are different kinds of leadership. Greater good is what public servants like you all, many of you, do. Right? But there is also something called self-leadership, and that's fine too. We will not make judgment as to which type. For both, you need tremendous. In fact, to make yourself as big as somebody like Federer, you need to lead yourself. And leading yourself is harder than leading other people, because you can easily cheat yourself, right? If I don't want to work hard, I cheat myself. I make an excuse and I'm okay. So the question is, what are these? Let me make it simple for you, because we have very little time left. The first thing that needs to happen to discover this kind of long-lasting energy is to have a set of very, very clear, deeply held values. What are those four or five things, principles, ideals, things that you believe in that you will never compromise no matter what happens? For Gandhiji, it was non-violence, humility, love, and truth. Whatever happens, he will not compromise against those, right? Whatever I usually in my longer sessions ask people a question, and it's a trick question, and people fall into the trap very quickly. And the trick question is, under what circumstances are you willing to compromise one of your deeply held values? And somebody will say, if it harms my family, I will compromise it. Somebody says, if it's good for the country, I will compromise it. And the answer is, if you compromise it even once, it is not a deeply held value. You ask Gandhiji that question, when are you willing to compromise non-violence? And he says, never. Even if it means harm to his own family, his ideals were never compromised. And that's what made him great. So is that clear? Most people cannot answer the question, what are my five deeply held values? Once you get really clear about what your values are, that determines who you are. That becomes your identity. Now, let's talk about how energy in the body is produced. You are clear about your values, and then you are faced with day-to-day life situations, right? For example, today you are listening to me. That is what's happening to you right now. And either you are feeling very happy and positive because what I'm saying agrees with your basic principles, or you are getting very angry and upset right now because what I'm saying is against your values. Either which way, either positive or negative energy is being produced. Either you are getting very inspired right now, or you are waiting to get out of here because you cannot tolerate it. Right? Both ways, either positive or negative energy is being produced right now. That's how energy is produced. It is produced when there is a match or a mismatch between one of your values and the situation around you. Does that make sense? at the intersection of your values and life, that is when energy is produced. Does that make sense? Gandhiji was upset when he was thrown out of that train in South Africa because he was traveling in first class and a brown person is not allowed. And that triggered so much energy that it rocked the history of the world. Unless you know your values, how will you know what will rock you? And if you don't know what rocks you, how can you rock the history of the world? Right? And then some people, they are so clear about their values and the energy, they start recognizing the energy that is produced. Now, for a lot of things, you will have energy, but not everything is something you will go all the way. So you have to choose your battles, right? Wisely. But for some people, some things, they make it their life's purpose. So from that values comes the energy, and as you recognize the energy, you pick one area of energy and make that your purpose. Now you have long-lasting energy. Because your purpose is values-based. In the case of Gandhiji, was he scared of the might of the British? No, not at all. Why was he not scared? They were the biggest military power in the world. Because his purpose came from a set of values that he believed so strongly. He says, for this purpose, I am prepared to die, but there is no purpose for which I am prepared to kill. And he would go fearlessly, empty-handed in front of anything and not be scared. Because the purpose came from a set of values. In his case, it was for greater good. That makes sense? But 95% of the people, unfortunately, cannot answer the question, what is your purpose? What are your values? In writing my first book, I had the privilege of interviewing a lot of big bosses, government bosses, military bosses, corporate bosses. I asked them all the same question. Sir, ma'am, what's your purpose? Most people couldn't answer it. You know what the most common answer was? Something like this. That's a very good question. Oh, I haven't thought about it. Oh, nobody has asked me that before. Yeah, exactly, right? And these are powerful people. And I feel like saying, look, a humble author like me who knows nothing about anything, you were waiting for me to ask you? And you call yourself a big leader? No, you are a big boss, not a big leader. Hence the title of the book, Too Many Bosses, Too Few Leaders. Lots of bosses. But that's not what makes you a leader. What you do makes you a leader, right? And then when you ask them about values, they've already embarrassed themselves by not being able to answer the purpose question, right? So here's the typical answer with values. Sir, ma'am, what are your values? Oh, yes, 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 I can answer that. So that's a much easier question. Of course I know my values. You know my my parents, right from when I was little, they instilled a set of values. They walk up and down five times, and they buy time to think, and then they say, so my values are integrity, honesty, hard work. They are making up the list as they go along. What are the chances that they are actually living that life? Zero. And people say, I am so busy, I don't have time to think about these things. If you don't have time to think about your values and your purpose, and developing a values-based purpose in life, how can you be happy? How can you be successful? I have seen some richest people in the world, actually they are the poorest people in the world, some of them, because they just don't have, they are still greedy for more. People have everything, they cannot count their wealth, and they are still hoarding more and more and more. And then there are people you meet who are doing such great work, and they have nothing inside their cupboards, but they are the richest people that you've met in your life, isn't it? And the secret is clarity of these two. Now the question is, how do you go from values to purpose? How much more time do we have? So I will make it another 10 minutes. Okay, so let me rush very quickly. So the question is, how do you find your purpose if you already have your values? First of all, finding values is hard enough. You've got to spend a long, long time. I used to be a trader on Wall Street, and it took me 10 years to get the courage to give up that and do what I'm doing now. So I'm no good example here, but I'm glad I arrived late because 90% don't even arrive. So what happens is, you start with values, and then you have to really do some deep thinking, as you were saying, sir. Deep thinking. Reflection. What's happened is today we have become too busy in the business of busyness. All of us have a supercomputer inside our pockets called a smartphone. And the moment we have one free moment in our life, out comes that supercomputer and we start doing all kinds of things. Right? What is the definition of a nanosecond? Anybody knows the definition of a nanosecond? It is the time lapse between when a millennial person receives a message and by the time he responds. Right? And it's not true of just millennials. Even us old people have started doing that. The moment we, We have time to spend on Facebook all day long, but we don't have time to reflect about who am I and why am I in this world. It's quite amazing, isn't it? Most people tell me, but between my office life and my home life, I have so many responsibilities, how can I think about myself? I say, but how many hours do you spend on Facebook or any of your favorite things? We are so busy in the business of busyness that we have stopped thinking. The only way to get to purpose is to deep think. And how do you deep think? I'll give you this very, very quickly, since we don't have that much time. The first base is to honestly answer what makes me happy, what makes me sad, what makes me angry. We all think we know the answers, but no, I'm asking you to think about it so deeply that you can begin to quantify. If you're happy, what is the level of joy? If you're sad or pain, what is the level of pain? You have to start recognizing that energy at a deep, deep level, being totally honest to yourself. Once you get true answers, you move to base three. Does this move me enough to want to create a better future? This pain or joy that I feel, does it move me enough that I want to do something about it? And if the answer is not a big, honest yes, that means you still haven't answered base one, go back. And that's what took me 10 years, by the way, so don't feel bad if it does. If the answers don't come in half an hour. If the answer is yes, then you move to four, who is the better future for? And here, what we need is emotional integrity, not emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence is to manage other people in a way that they will like you, in a nutshell, right? Emotional integrity is looking in the mirror and saying, this is what I want for myself and I don't care what society thinks. Is admitting to yourself what I really want. If you want to be the richest and the most powerful person in the world, God bless you, go ahead and do it. But don't say, I want to serve society if that's what you want. Or vice versa. The important thing is emotional integrity. So who is the better future for? For you, for your family, or for the whole world? Has to be very, very honest. You know, we ask a research question around the world to people all over the world. The question is, what is the most important thing in your life? What do you care about the most? Right? Guess what is the most common answer anywhere in the world? Question is, what is the most important thing in your life? What do you care about the most? Family, right? Family. It is so untrue for a lot of people. And yet they say family. Because you look at their diary of the last 6 months, there is no evidence that family is number one. Yet they all say family. So why are they lying? For some people it is true, but for a lot of people it's not true. So when it's not true and they still say family, why? What do you think? It's the societally correct thing to say, isn't it? And what emotional integrity says, no. Look in the mirror and admit to yourself what you really want. Unless you can make yourself happy, you cannot serve other people, and service is leadership. So you can't be a leader. So 100% emotional integrity. Then, how does it feel when I visualize it? Is this better future that I want to create? When I close my eyes and pretend it's already here, how does it feel when I visualize it? Unless it feels totally ecstatic and you feel so overjoyed that it's almost real, if that's not the case, that means you still haven't answered base one. Go back to base one until that picture becomes so powerful. If it is full of ecstasy, then you go to the last one. Am I willing to face great resistance and great personal risk? Again, if your practical brain says, no, that's too much risk. What about my family? What about me? Blah, blah, blah. Answer is, you haven't discovered base one. Go back to base one. Only if the answer to number six is an emphatic yes, now you have discovered fearless purpose. This is the journey of 1,000 miles that Mahatma Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, Howard Schultz, and all those people that you admire have gone through. It's all about deep thinking. That is how you lose fear. That is how you lose fear. When you start living an authentic life of values and a values-based purpose. Now you're not scared because the picture of that better future is so powerful that you say, what can you do? You can kill me? You can hurt me? Do so. But the picture of what I'm seeing in my mind is so powerful that it's worth the pain. The pain today has to be less than the joy of the picture that you have in your mind. That's called fearless purpose. And this is what 95% of the people in the world do not do. So as you walk out of here today, ask yourself, what are my values? And do I have a values-based purpose? And I don't care how old you are or how young you are, it's never too late. I've seen people in their 70s go down this path and discover fearless purpose. It's never too late. Yeah. So then, that's the journey. And I will skip a few things here. clarifying your personal purpose and values. Now the question is, you have to also have something called humble confidence. I want to create a better future. I have to have the confidence that yes, a better future can be created, but also the humility to know that I cannot do it alone. I cannot do it alone, but we can. So the next thing that needs to happen with this is, how do I create a team around me where this team and I can create a better future? And I'll just offer you a basic idea here because we don't have much time. And that is, the people that report to you immediately, your immediate one step lower, instead of calling them subordinates, make them your co-leaders. And the big difference between leading a team of subordinates and who take orders from you and leading a team of co-leaders. Only if you are very comfortable in your own skin will you be able to give them that kind of power to challenge you, to become co-leaders. And how will you be comfortable in your skin? When you live a life of values and purpose. Other than that, if you don't have clarity of values and purpose, by the way, you may become richer and richer and richer. You will still keep hoarding. You will still keep pursuing more product and power, and happiness will be elusive. So that's the trick in terms of the great leaders who actually create better futures. They move from I to we, and they treat their direct reports as co-leaders. And then how now, finally, 2 minutes more, how, together with your co-leaders, do you energize the whole system? Even a team alone cannot do it, right? If you run a large company, or you run a state, or you run a government, you have, just the ministers can't do it, just the cap. You have to take hundreds of thousands of people with you, right? How do you energize the masses? In the corporate sector or in the public sector? And I'll just give you the gist of it. In our research, we find that senior leadership teams that focus on only three things and worry about nothing else, they create together better futures for the world. And what are those three things? We call those three things the brains, the bones, and the nerves. The brains, the bones, and the nerves. And what do I mean by that? Let me just quickly jump a few things. Here we are. The brain of your organization, whether private sector or public sector, is the vision, mission, and strategy. Set such a compelling vision and mission and strategy that it energizes people. Show them the picture of the better future and how we are going to get there. And focus energy on creating that amazing brain that everybody wants to join. Bones is people, process, and structure. Get the right people, put the right processes in place, and get the right structure going. And you have to manage that every day, every week, not once in 2 years. And the nerves is the most important. What is the culture of your organization? How do people actually interact? Do they live the values, or are the values only posters on the wall? Yeah? If you want to read more about this, it's in my books and lots of articles. I can give you some web links, or you can pick up the books. But one last thing. If you are a leadership team that wants to create a better future, and you want to make sure that as a leadership team, you are shaping the brains, bones, and nerves of your organization correctly. But if the brains, bones, and nerves of your organization are unhealthy and unproductive, who will be the first people to find out? So you are the leaders. In your organization, if the brains, bones, and nerves are unhealthy, who will be the first people to find out? No, before the leader, who will find out? Workers, your staff. So how can you find out whether you as a leadership team are doing the best job of maximizing energy? Ask your workers, right? So I want to leave you with a quick cheat sheet. What we did is, we created 5 statements for brains, 5 for bones, 5 for nerves. You send them out as a survey to your staff, and they apply equally to government and to private sector, equally, right? Whether you're profit, not-for-profit service. And I'm going to give you that survey tool. It takes 7 minutes to fill out. When you average the data, you will know how much energy there is in your organization or not. So let me skip. These are 5 for brains, 5 for bones, and I'll show you what you do with it. You put up a form online like this. I wish I had more time to explain a few of these, but doesn't matter, another time. And you send it out, anonymous survey, and have people fill it out on a 1 to 5 scale, whether strongly agree, disagree, right? For example, let me just give you one example. Our supporting systems and structures, the way we reward people, does it encourage the right performance or does it encourage the wrong performance? If people give a low score on number 2, means that your bureaucratic systems are not working. So these are the kind of statements, right? So you put them all on a form and ask people to rate on 1 to 5. When the data comes back, as I said, it takes 7 minutes, you can put it all on one page. in one graph like this, right? And now you have a discussion with your co-leaders. What does this mean? Come on, folks, what can we do to create a better future? How can we energize our organization? And the discussion will be totally focused. Can you guess? This is a company profile. What is the biggest problem in this company? Culture? Does everybody agree? And that's the wrong answer. I'm sorry. Why is it the wrong answer? Yes, culture is the lowest score, but this is not a mathematical tool. What is the biggest problem here? Okay, let me give you a hint. A score of 1 means strongly disagree, 2 means disagree, 3 means neither agree nor disagree, 4 is agree, 5 is strongly agree. Now tell me, what is the biggest problem here? Brains. People don't know where this company is going. And if you don't know where it is going, what kind of structure, what kind of people, and what kind of culture are you going to have? Right? So it gives you lots of information. What you can also do is add a 16th question, which says comments, any other comments, and ask people. Now you have the numbers and you have the comments. It will still take only 10 minutes, and you will have amazing information about the level of energy of the organization. So that's all, my friends. Leadership is about closing your eyes and imagining a better future and not giving up. For that, you have to first find your own energy. Where does your own energy come from? From deep conviction in values and developing a values-based purpose, because then you are not scared anymore. But humble confidence, I cannot do it alone. It's not I, it's we, and they are my co-leaders, not my direct reports, not my juniors, my co-leaders. And you have to be big enough to be able to make co-leaders. Does that make sense? And then finally, together with your co-leaders, you shape 24/7, 365, the brains, the bones, and the nerves of your organization. And if you do it this way, you have to keep recharging yourself, because you will feel like giving up. You're human, right? When the system gets against us, when everything is corrupt and difficult, then you say, oh, what can I do? You will need to find the way to recharge your battery. There's two things. One, close your eyes and reimagine that better future as if it's already here. That visualization will recharge you, right? And then you ask, okay, what is the one next step I can do despite all the difficulties? And that one step will make become two, will become three, will become four. So that's the first step. Reimagine, revisualize. And finally, you have to, absolutely have to, develop a daily routine of some sort of meditation. Now we have enough scientific evidence. Dr. Behal was saying something about quantum physics and neuroscience and said you were very curious about that. Now we have proof from quantum physics and neuroscience that says that if you meditate even for 20 minutes in a day, that recharges you like anything. It's not physical energy. We are talking about spiritual energy. So visualization and brain rehearsals plus a little bit of meditative time and you re-energize yourself. So that's all I have to share. I'm sorry if I shot over time a little bit, but thank you. You've been a very, very participative audience, and I certainly hope you enjoyed a little bit as well. Thank you very much.
I encourage you to ask any questions that you may have of the speaker. Rajeev, thank you so, so much. This has been a wonderful session for all of us, and I'm sure there's so much more still to learn from you, which is why if anybody has any questions, feel free to ask Rajeev. Or any topic that he could just very briefly touch because of time, and now you have the time to ask him. Where's the mic? Give him a mic.
The benevolency is the most important thing, which has to be integrated with the commitment.
Sir, that is usually true because you are thinking about leadership in terms of greater good, right?
Yes.
And therefore, benevolency is what? It's a value. So is it one of your five values? Absolutely. Then you are about greater good. But some leadership is about individual leadership, in which case not necessary. So depends on what the scope of your leadership is. Generally speaking, for greater good, you are absolutely right. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Would you say that in today's context, if you don't mind my asking this question,
sure.
The Tatas, they appear to have failed in succession planning. Just the impression, your comments.
Yes. So here's the situation, sir. Succession planning methods all over the world, including in India, have become totally outdated. It is one of the subjects in my new book. Typically what happens with succession planning in organizations is you make a grid of 9 boxes. One side is performance, one side is potential, and you say who are my high potential and high performing people, and I'm going to train them, I'm going to give them exposure and get them systematically to the next level. So these are my succession pool, right? It's called the 9 box grid, popularized by the GE company. Those days are over, sir. Right? Why? Because today there is no way in which you can say who your stars are going to be 5 years from now. Because what the situation and context of the world will be 5 years from now, nobody knows. Until 1985, that method of succession planning was very, very good. Yeah? Because life was pretty predictable. Today you can't say that. So, question is, how do you do succession planning? Here's an alternative. Let the cream rise to the top naturally. What do I mean by that? Every year, give your organization a challenge to all employees or to all members if it is a private public sector. Anybody that has an idea to do something for this company or for this organization or for this government or for this city, come up with your idea, form a team, present your idea within 3 months, and the best ideas will be selected and empowered and implemented. Anybody and everybody is allowed to participate, but there is no need, no compulsion, right? Now the people that participate and raise their hands voluntarily every year, year after year after year, they are your natural leaders for tomorrow, right? What is the need for all this artificial succession planning? Let the cream rise to the top. Some of the best companies in the world have come up with multi-billion dollar ideas through this process. And yet, you know, we use antiquated human resources processes of doing that. That's the problem with Tatas and everywhere else. Yes, sir.
Do you agree with me if I say that apart from perseverance, governance, conviction, selflessness, all the qualities, some degree of luck might be involved? What I am saying is, for one Gandhi, one Mandela to survive, come off, there could be 99 others who just are like killed in the prison and gone.
Great, yeah, great question. So the question was, in case you couldn't hear, that in spite of all the energy and perseverance and vision and all that, a fair amount of luck is also required, because for one Gandhi, you know, he succeeds and 99 others die and fail. That is the question. And the question is, do you agree that luck plays a big role?
But there is a saying, sir, luck also favors
the prepared mind. Exactly right. So my answer was going to be very similar, and that is this. Unless you close your eyes and visualize a better future, and unless you are clear about your values, I can guarantee you, you will 100% not succeed. If you close and visualize, and if you have a values-based purpose, there is a much greater chance of succeeding. So luck will come. If the first step has to come from us, of course. So I say two things. You said one, which is leadership is a choice. So I say leadership is a choice, not a position or a title. The second line of the quote is leadership is a journey, not a destination. So once you are on a values-based purpose journey, you better learn to enjoy the journey, because the result is in God's hands. For Gandhi, there was a Bhagat Singh who died in his 20s. Was he any less a great leader? No. And the unknown soldier who died, whose name is not even on India Gate, was he any less a leader in India's struggle? No, they were equally great leaders. So the question is, we have to get the process started. Anything else? Yes, sir. Sir, say again.
See, whether you are referring to the demonetization of 500,000 notes, people are standing in the queue and suffering. It may be, the pain may be temporary, but it may be for good happiness in future, for national happiness.
I will not make a comment on the demonetization, but I will say one thing, that how do you decide that the current pain is worth taking when the future tomorrow is better, right? And how do you decide the better future? Again, it comes back to your values and your purpose, right? Only your values and your purpose will decide whether today's pain is worth taking in return for a better tomorrow. But again, if you don't have values and purpose clarity, you cannot make those decisions. Most people complain about everything in life. Everything is a negative, glass half empty, not glass half full. Why? Because they have no clarity of values and purpose. So I agree with you, but again, comes back to the basics, right? Yes, sir.
Nature versus nurture.
Yes.
It seems to be loaded in favor of leaders are made.
Yes. Yeah.
Take on that.
Absolutely what you just said. So whether they are born or made, nurture versus nature, clearly made. Now the thing is, if I just go back for a second here, remember when I walked you through the reflective journey of the six bases of reflection, of deep thinking? This one, right? Look at the title of this slide. It says, discovering your leadership energy by living life awake. Unfortunately, most of us are such slaves to our smartphones and technology, we are not thinking anymore, we are living life like zombies, we are not living life awake. So if you live life awake, the leader in you will be born. Why? Because you will feel deeply about the inadequacy of something and say, I want to change it. So a leader is definitely made, but if you live life awake, yeah? You definitely can have late bloomers. That's exactly right.
So, my question is that, does a leader cognate the things differently?
Does the leader?
Cognate the things differently than others.
Organizing. Yes, of course. Of course. A leader gives his or her people what they need, which is not necessarily what they want. And you have to have the courage and conviction to do that. Again, energy. Unless you have a values-based purpose, because you know what? Most people are in the popularity context. And if anything makes you unpopular, even for the short term, we don't like to do it because we are societal beings. And there's nothing wrong with that. Either you say, I don't want to be a leader. I want to smell the roses. I just want to live a simple life. I want people to love me and like me. That's fine. But if you have donned the hat of leadership, then you have to. Because Jeff Bezos, who was the founder and CEO of Amazon.com, right? Here's what he has to say about leadership. He says, you want to be a leader? Think again. Because if you want to be a leader, be prepared for four things. You will be very unpopular for a long period of time. You will be very lonely for a long period of time. You will be very misunderstood for a long period of time. And there is no guarantee that you will succeed in creating a better future. So the return on investment in leadership is very low. Do you really want to be a leader? But then he goes on to say, but those people who have closed their eyes and imagined a better future, they cannot sleep, like our Abdul Kalamji said. They cannot sleep. They make the choice of leadership. To them, loneliness and misunderstanding, not a problem. Same as your point, today's pain for a greater future, coming from clarity of values and purpose.
Yes, the classic leadership posture. How do you explain Hitler's leadership in terms of framework?
So, again, the question was, how do you explain Hitler's leadership in all of this? And so, sir, for this we need an hour, but I will just say one thing. In my book, according to my definition of leadership, leadership is the art of harnessing human energy towards the creation of a better future. So in my book, Hitler is not a leader. Why? The key word is the word better. He thought he was cleansing the world and making the world a better place. But history told us that people disregarded that and his values were wrong. He was okay with 6 million people being killed, etc. So history decided. So very important question is, how do you know whether you are creating a better future or not?
Now, did
he make Germany the biggest power, or I don't know. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Militarily, at that time.
Yeah.
Right, but I think Germany is a bigger power today because of his technological prowess than it was in his time. So the question is, who decides if you're creating a better future? Future means unknown, correct? Means you are in uncharted territory. How do you know it's going to be better or worse? There is no answer to that. You look at all the literature on ethics and morality, and right and wrong, and no clue. I have studied this from ancient literature to modern literature, from Aristotle to Immanuel Kant, and there is no real answer as to how do you decide between right or wrong. Some people say greater good. Some people say right of duty. Yeah, so on what is the point? So people say that if it is for the greater good, that's the right thing to do. Meaning, on one side, there are 50 people. On the other side, there's one fat man. And you have the choice to turn the train this way or that way. How many will you kill? Your actual path was going this way. Will you kill 50 or will you kill one? Most people say, killing one is better than 50. But then you ask them a slightly different question, that if you are the one who has to turn the handle and kill that one person, will you do it? No, I won't do it. Right? So the question is, how do you decide these things? Again, it goes back to emotional integrity and saying, am I okay with these values and with this purpose? Can I sleep well at night? Am I okay with the collateral damage? And if the answer is yes, you move forward and then let history decide. So that word better is the most important word in there. And that comes from values. Yes, sir? In just 1 minute at the back. Of course, it should be sustainable future.
Because
Sure. You're absolutely right. Sustainable better future is something that is you have, and that's where, in my view, that's where values come in, right? Because if you're looking for short-termism gain, that means it's based on a different set of values. So the problem with creating these spiffy definitions is that you leave out a lot, isn't it? But very much sustainable is built into it. So if you were with me for a day, we would talk a lot about sustainability. Okay.
So you mentioned about the leaders from the West to the East.
Yes.
These three great leaders. And you mentioned that they were largely driven by the values. How about they were largely also moved by the miseries of the masses? And
known for?
They were also moved by the miseries of the masses.
Yes.
And what and how are the traits they developed by seeing these miseries?
So again,
and how did it play out?
So again,
thank
what
you.
Feeling others' pain is what, sir? It's about your values. Right? So, some people feel others' pain and some people don't feel others' pain. Basic difference is the values of yours. I care only about money and my power. I don't care about other people suffering. That's because my value is money and fame. You may be feeling others' pain and misery. You're more on that direction. So again, it comes down to values, isn't it? So which is what most people think they know their values and purpose. You know, most of us, when we are growing up, sorry, sir, 1 minute. When we are growing up, our parents send us to good schools and colleges. And then the thing becomes, let's get a good job. Government job, private sector job. Let's become successful. Success is money. Let's buy a house. Let's get married. Let's have children. Now let's have bigger house. Now let's have bigger car. And that's how we measure success. Very few people think about the questions that we talked about today. Now you are measuring success in a totally different way. As to what have I done in this world, in my small humble way, that by the time my journey is over in this planet, I've made the world a slightly better place.
Sir, my question may be a funny question. But how many such leaders who proved that they're really leaders, they started their plan like this, how I can be a leader, and how many of them aware that I want to become a so big person and reached?
Great question.
They, all of them, they didn't have any trained like this.
Yes.
I want to become a leader,
yes.
So I have to go so and so and so, qualities I must have. So none of the leaders have anything like that, but they have got their own ambition and their own way they have done it. So it is, this all gives an idea of the leaders. But it is not the real, I don't agree with any particular quality or trait or anybody thing that can be, bring him a leader.
Sir,
a leader is a leader when he, of his own style and own methodology. There's no system, there's no nothing, any predicted system or anything like that to make him a great leader. None of the leaders, they're aware of that they're going to be such a leader in the beginning.
You're absolutely right. I am in violent agreement with you. No disagreement whatsoever. Yeah. So here's the deal. Nobody is born knowing this is the path to great leadership and I am going to do great leadership kind of work. No, the only difference is some people wake up and start asking them the questions, themselves the question, who am I and why am I here? And the majority of us don't ask those two questions. That's the difference, sir. Some people wake up and some people don't wake up even until their last day. Right? You know, there was a nurse in Australia. She worked for 2 years in palliative care in the hospital where she's giving care to people who have just a few weeks to live. Right? And she asked about 200 dying people, what are your top regrets in life? And then she wrote a book called The Top 5 Regrets of the Dying. And you know what was the number one regret cited by most people when they are about to die at 85, 90, whatever years age? Can you guess? Exactly. I wish I had lived a life true to myself, not the life that others expected me to live. I kept living my whole life because my parents wanted me to get a good job, because my society wanted me to do this, but I wish I hadn't crushed my own dreams. So the two miracle questions that we must start asking is, who am I and why am I here? That's it. That's the only difference. But everybody reaches that place in a different way. You're totally right.
Actually, I have a question. This charisma is also a very important trait for leadership. But charisma is built over a period of time based on the values they follow throughout their life. Whether it is Gandhiji or Martin Luther King or Mandela, they had very high charisma. But still, we have seen many leaders in the country as well as in the worldwide, that there are many leaders who had charisma, still not of very high values, but how do you see that?
So I may disappoint you with my answer, sir, but in our research, we have found that charisma has nothing to do with leadership. Charisma helps you as a leader, but it is not a prerequisite of leadership. Lots and lots. If I ask you to make a list of your top 10 most admired leaders, some will be charismatic, some will be non. Second point, people like Gandhi did not have great charisma to start with. He is somebody who was very timid. He used to stand and talk like this. But then, as he became aware of his values and purpose, he developed an aura. He developed a charisma. So again, what is true deep charisma comes from living a life of values and a values-based purpose. But charisma is not a prerequisite for great leadership.
And
I believe that was the last question,
yes.
Right?
Okay. I know we have lots of questions to ask Rajeev. So. And for those of you whose questions were not answered or who didn't get the opportunity, I request you to please approach him independently after the session. And I'm sure Rajeev would love to answer your questions. With that, I would now like to invite the Honorable Lieutenant Governor to come and address us with the valedictory remarks. Thank you.
Something was going to make the difference in us. The questions which came to my mind as a conclusion for the valedictory were, while you were saying, I was writing exactly that, a little before even you said it. I think questions which we can go as a conclusion is, who am I? If we are authentic to ourselves and actually, who am I, man or a woman? Position or a good person, who am I? Am I a son or a better daughter or a spouse? Who am I? Who all am I? I think question is, it can be defined in many, many ways. Then, why am I here? Why am I here? Why am I healthier than compared to others? Why do I have more than many others? So second question. Third, what is my real purpose? Wherever I am and of my life, what's my real purpose? What is the real purpose even of my responsibility? What's my purpose? Is it to mark time or is it to make the difference or do nothing or do everything? I don't know. I think these are the questions which you have provoked within me as a conclusion. Who am I? Why am I here? What is my real purpose? How can I do it better? If I'm doing better, can I do it better? If so, how? What is it that I said? Am I generating commensurate energy? Am I generating energy within, commensurate to my purpose for which I'm here? So am I generating energy? Because if I won't generate energy, I exhaust out physically, mentally, spiritually, not financially, mentally, spiritually, physically. And then, am I making the difference in the purpose of my responsibility, whichever way I may take, father, mother, public servant, leader, whoever it be. So am I making the difference in the purpose of my responsibility? I think these are the questions you're leaving me with today. I do not know how many of us are being left with many questions, but I think this is what this thought thinking is about. I want to thank Rajeev for leaving these questions for me. What questions are being left with others are individual choices to be made. But that's the beginning of our thought series. And Rajeev, you are our first. You're the first. And we are really privileged. I've heard Rajeev many times earlier. Fortunately, we could catch him. He was traveling to this part of the country. And we got to know Rajeev is traveling this. We requested him, don't stop at Chennai or go back after Tirupati. Come to Pondicherry. And Rajeev accepted our request to come with his family, to be with us today. He's an exceedingly busy man, exceedingly sought after. Every minute of his, I know, is exceedingly tight, demanded, but he spared more than a day for us and to be with us, with his family. I think you've done us a lot of good. You blessed us by your brilliant wisdom. I hope you can leave some books with us and gift one book to my chief secretary, who's I'm so happy to see with his family, one of our main leaders, education minister, our speaker. I think it'll do, when the speaker gets it, everybody gets it. And when my chief secretary gets it, everybody gets it. I think the two real leaders who are sitting amongst us in governance, in whereas in at local in administration, and as legislative assembly, the speaker and the chief secretary. I think it's such a joy that many of you thinkers are here, and that you found the time to be with us, friends. Raj Nivas will continue to promote this kind of thinking. This was a dining hall once, no more. I think we will eat here more than in our stomachs. We'll find our own tables and chairs to eat, but I think this is the what it was meant for, and we are remembering those. Now you might ask, why Mr. Malkani, why Mr. Gurjar, why Mr. Chedilal? Why? I just happened to ask our colleagues, co-leaders, as you rightly said, co-leaders, saying, let's do something in their memory. I every day see so many pictures when I enter, but tell me, who do you remember most? I was keen to find out who out of these 20, 25 are most admired and respected. Consensus came on these three: Mr. Malkani, Mr. Gurjar, and Mr. Chedilal. Then I start to ask why. I was curious, why him? Why him? Everybody had a different trait. Everybody had something very outstanding. Srinivas said it, his. Mr. Niti Das had his own. Sridhar had his own. Because they're all institutional memory here in one form or the other. And we thought we'll perpetuate their memory. So the first three lectures, three presentations would go in their name. And then we'll come up with Dr. Kalam and many others. So everybody we get to know who's visiting Pondicherry and is a thought thinker for us, we're going to grab them and bring them to the erstwhile dining hall and now a lecture hall trained for the Raj Nivas to continue to contribute to cerebral, spiritual, upward thinking. So once again, Rajeev, thank you so much that you spared your time. I hope you felt nice. You felt that we were absorbing you. I hope you felt we were loving it and relishing it. I have no doubt about it. But I think in the coming weeks and months, we'll see the results. Thank you very much.